Hello everyone, welcome to our next Myth++ seminar. Today I will continue talking about periodic lattices and the seminar today will be about three-dimensional lattices. So joint work with Matt Bright, Andy Cooper at Applied Materials Innovation Factory at Liverpool. So let me start from basic definitions. So a lattice is defined by a linear basis in any n-dimensional space. The pictures here illustrate two-dimensional examples, but we will talk mainly about the three-dimensional case today. So we study lattices up to isometries because crystal structures are determined in a rigid form. That's why it's very natural to study crystals and, in particular, crystal lattices up to rigid motion or isometry. And today, this will be really a general isometry, also including reflections. So not because it's hard to exclude reflections, but only because this is the most basic generic case. And in the future, we will consider lattices only up to rigid motion or orientation preserving isometries and also up to similarities, similarly to the two-dimensional case. Okay, so if we fix our equivalence relation as an isometry, then the resulting space of equivalence classes, so I called it briefly lattice isometry space, it contains infinitely many classes of lattices. Infinitely many, this is a continuous space, and that's why it's hard to imagine and classify. But this is our aim, is to understand this space list. So more formally, the problem I would like to solve is to find a complete isometry invariant, which is a map, a function on this lattice isometry space to a simpler space. So that simpler space will be the space of root invariants of lattices, presented a bit later. Invariance means that the invariant should take the same value on any isometric lattices. The second condition, completeness, is much harder to satisfy, and it means that our invariant should take the same value only on isometric lattices. And also, we'd like to have a metric on lattices defined in terms of this invariance, a metric satisfying the standard metric axioms. Most importantly, the first one. So this metric distance, d, should be zero if and only if two lattices are isometric. Right, so the past work. So I cannot mention every past work, but only important developments. So I actually recently learned about papers and the book. So this is the first reference is the book, Mathematical Foundations of Structural Analysis of Crystals by Delaunay and two co-authors in 1934. So this is a great book. I think it is published in Russian, and I'm not sure there is an English translation. But I'm actually planning to translate important parts and even insert them as an appendix in papers later. So I will later discuss what was done exactly by Delaunay and, of course, later by Conway. And I certainly should mention Larry Andrews and Herbert Bernstein, who in the past over 40 years did a lot of work. So put these references in full in the papers. So in our more recent work with Matt and Andy, we have two preprints on the archive, which actually are very early versions. So there were, substantial updates, and the most latest update for the two-dimensional case is available at this link. And if you replace 2D by 3D, then you get the most recent three-dimensional version of our papers. Okay, so let's start from the first key concept of superbase. So it makes sense in any dimension. If you have a linear basis V1, etc., Vn, then we could add one extra vector V0 and get a superbase. So what should I add here, right on this slide? But we consider not only a superbase, we consider obtuse superbases. Obtuse means that all pairwise angles between n plus one vectors here are non-acute, 90 degrees or more. In two dimensions, we have the following examples. So in a generic case, if you have a basis v1, v2, then the complementary vector v0 is minus v1 minus v2. So we have a triple of vectors in this obtuse superbase. And we could always produce a symmetric or opposite obtuse superbase by changing the signs. Okay, the yellow region here denotes the Voronoi domain, formally defined here in the plane for simplicity. And you might notice that under perturbations, the Voronoi domain is combinatorially unstable. And this is actually an important obstacle to define continuous metrics. However, if we consider these Voronoi domains geometrically, not combinatorially, then there is a way to define formally a distance, a continuous distance between Voronoi domains and consequently lattices. However, this distance is rather theoretic because it involves a minimization over infinitely many rotations. Today, we will also have some minimizations, but much simpler than that. Okay, now, now indeed, a three-dimensional case only. In this case, we have an obtuse superbase of four vectors. V1, V2, V3 are standard, well, any basis, and V0 is opposite. Then, for this superbase, Conway and Sloan defined the following quantities, Vo norms and co norms. So, Vo norms are simply, so there are four Vo norms. V1 squared, this is simply the square of the first basis vector, the squared length. V1, V2 squared, so similarly the squared length. V3 squared, and then also squared lengths of these sums. So they're called partial sums in the paper by Conway. There is an extra seventh conorm here, V0 squared. But there is also a linear relation between these seven Vo norms. So the relation is written here. That's why instead of seven Vo norms, we could consider a dual object consisting of only six conorms. And these conorms are negative scalar products of our superbase vectors. So if you take negative scalar products, then conorms are not negative, and that's why it's very natural to take square roots of these conorms, and that's how we get root products that are measured in the same units as original coordinates. For example, if you take crystal lattices from the Cambridge structural database where all unit lengths are in angstroms, then these root products will be also in angstroms. Okay, now let me, so this was introduced by Conway and Sloan in 92. However, earlier, a lot time earlier in 1934, Delaunay proposed to consider similar scalar products, so not negative, but usual scalar products, so not positive. And put them not on triangles from the previous slide, but on a much more symmetric tetrahedron. So imagine a tetrahedron in a three-dimensional space. It has six edges, and these six scalar products can be naturally put onto edges of this tetrahedron. And he formally proved, so sorry that this theorem is in Russian. It is a screenshot indeed from his book. The theorem says that these six products on a tetrahedron are enough to reconstruct, to build any lattice in the three-dimensional space. However, there was one important question left. Yes, so we could have co-forms of these scalar products, so six of them, arranged on a tetrahedron or as Conway did on a triangle. When do these co-forms represent isometric lattices? So what are these configurations of six numbers that correspond to isometric lattices? So Conway claimed that these six conorms are isometry invariants. And unfortunately, this claim is stated in such a way that it looks a bit weak because, well, if you have six numbers, you need to know how to compare one six tuple with another six tuple. And that's the key question. Because if you start permuting them arbitrarily, this doesn't work. Of course, we could do much smarter. We could consider what happens when we permute vectors of our bases, super base. There are only four vectors, so four factorial permutations, 24. And of course, so Larry Anderson, Herbert Bernstein, they mentioned 24 permutations in the past work as well. However, it turns out that these four factorial permutations are not enough to formally get an invariant. So let's now consider these permutations first. So what happens if you swap vectors 1 and 2? Yeah, the pictures are a bit complicated, but with vor norms on the top row and co norms earlier, in the low part, so they change like that. So 1, 2 is actually very simple. We swap the first two columns if you represent our co-form in terms of a 2x3 matrix. So basically, indeed, we swap indices 1 and 2, and that's why we swap the corresponding co-norms. If you swap vector 0 and 1, this is a bit harder to see because we don't have column number 0. We have only columns 1, 2, 3. But let me explain what we do with diagonal swap in columns 2 and 3. 2 and 3 because, well, it's different from 1. So we do with diagonal swap, and that's how we generate 24 permutations on these co-forms. Any questions so far? Okay, so far we have started from an ordered super base, and we would like to understand what happens with our co-norms and or co-form containing all six of them under simply reordering our bases. Of course, reordering of a basis doesn't change lattice, that's why it's important. However, what is interesting here, what so far we considered only one superbase. Yeah, there is an opposite superbase minus b when we change the sign. And of course, this opposite superbase has the same co-form. So scalar products do not change. And also, if you have two isometric superbases, again, nothing changes. Like a form stays the same. And here you see an example for a very simple cubic lattice. So hopefully you see the standard orthogonal basis. Three vectors, red, green, blue, and the opposite vector, the orange one, so the diagonally opposite, which is minus V1, minus V2, minus V3. So instead of that super base based on a standard basis, we could choose any of 7 more very similar super bases starting from another triple of orthogonal or orthonormal basis vectors. Right, so we have 8 in total, and they're all related by either rotations or reflections. But are there any more obtuse superbases? And it turns out that there are. And that's why formally this co-form considered up to 24 permutations is formally not an invariant. Okay, so to consider more complicated cases, yes, I need to mention the Voronoi domain of any lattice in the three-dimensional space. There are 5 types, V1, V2, V3, V4, V5. V5 is a cuboid, a rectangular parallelepiped. So ABC, this ABC will be different from my ABC later. So here alpha, beta, gamma are simply edge lengths of this cuboid. So, so after studying now the past work by Dylan, I am now more sure than before that this key question was not fully answered in the past. So namely, what obtuse superbases can we have in the same three-dimensional lattice? So what's the difference between them? In the two-dimensional case, if you remember my past talk, any two-dimensional lattice has only isometric obtuse superbases. This was easy, but for three-dimensional case is much more interesting. Okay, so let's start from a generic case. So when we have a truncated octahedron, so the most general lattice of type V1, Voronoi type V1, then indeed it has only two isometric superbases, only two pairs, so very similar to the two-dimensional case. So coform can be written in, as this matrix 2 by 3. Yes, so we could do also Delaunay tetrahedron in a more symmetric way, but only for simplicity, I write it as a 2 by 3 matrix, simply because it's easier to write a matrix on a slide. And indeed, all obtuse superbases of lambda of this type are indeed related by 24 permutations. So it wasn't, I think it wasn't formally proved because it wasn't even formally stated, neither in Conway paper, neither in Delaunay's book. So these 24 permutations were somehow mentioned previously, but I couldn't find this statement previously. Now, the second case, Voronoi type V2. This is already more complicated because in this case, our obtuse superbase has two orthogonal vectors, say V2, V3. And we have more freedom to choose obtuse superbases. So we have more potentially non-acute angles, well, including angles of degree of 90 degrees. So in this case, we might have two potentially non-isometric superbases. So if we start from one, then we could produce also one more. So in that case, one conorm is zero, and we could put it in this place by using 24 permutations, because we have the freedom to permute columns, for example. So our zero could be at the top left position. And also this conorm could be the smallest from this submatrix. So later clarify it a bit more, but at the moment, any coform could be put into this form, but also, if you consider all potential superbases, well, these two non-isometric, then they're all related not only by 24 permutations, but if you fix this form with zero at the top and the smallest minimal, the smallest element of the submatrix at as P13, then we also have the extra symmetries of a square. The symmetry group D4 acts on this submatrix by rotating that square or by reflections, diagonal reflections. And this gives more symmetry. So that's why the previous 24 permutations were not enough. In the third case, here we have two pairs of orthogonal vectors, and in addition to the previous two superbases, we have one more, B3. In that case, all coforms are isomorphic to this. I don't have a specific name because here I still consider co-norms, not root products, but it has two zeros in one column, and this column could be put into the first position for simplicity. Then, if you consider all potential superbases of flat lattice in that form, then we have even more freedom. We could permute these four conorms completely freely. So the permutation group S4 acts on this submatrix, not D4 as in the previous case, but S4. Right, so this was, so these cases were a bit complicated because the Voronoi domain is hard to imagine. In the fourth case, it's easier. So the Voronoi domain of the fourth type is simply a hexagonal prism. So imagine any generic two-dimensional lattice and a vector V3, vertical vector orthogonal to this generic two-dimensional lattice. That's how we get any lattice of type V4. So it's based on a hexagonal prism. So in this case, we have two obtuse superbases B1, B2 as in the case V2, and a different one. So B4, so not from the previous case V3, but different. So these cases V3 and V4 were parallel. So they are not extensions of each other. So in that case, we have two zero conorms, so coming from these two scalar products in one row. So not in one column, but in one row. And for simplicity, we could put them at the beginning here. Now, if you consider all obtuse superbases of this lattice, then there is still flexibility as follows. We could permute these three non-zero conorms freely by the group S3. So all possible permutations. So please notice what this conorm stays. And actually, it has a very simple geometric interpretation. So this conorm P03 is formally an invariant. It is simply the squared length of that vector V3, of that orthogonal vector. So that's why it is a well-defined invariant here. Okay, and finally, before I discuss the final case cuboid, let me explain what Delaunay did in 1934. So this picture in the middle, this is a screenshot from the book by Delaunay with co-authors did a long time ago. So Delaunay came, I think, very close to a complete classification. Well, so nearly 90 years ago, of course, the style of writing in mathematics was different. So he didn't use notations as Conway did 30 years ago. And well, pictures were much harder to draw. And well, this period in the history of USSR was rather hard, so everything is understandable. Delaunay predicted, or well, claimed, because there was no formal proof. There were some comments, discussions, but no formal proof, only a statement. But for a cuboid, there are three classes of obtuse superbases. So one class you have seen already previously. So we start from a standard orthonormal basis and add the opposite diagonal vector, one class. And he claimed two more classes. So this number two, he explains two more classes, although the picture is a single one. However, there are not two more classes. There are three more classes, and each of them contains not six, but eight superbases. And sorry, I didn't have time to draw pictures, but I think numbers are simple enough for you actually to check the statement in a very simple example. So if we start from a cuboid with edge lengths 1, 2, 3. So the first class is simple. We could take an orthonormal basis, and we have eight choices of signs. So we could take, for example, all pluses, and this is the standard case. And in my notations here, the upper sign always corresponds to the upper sign in the same column. So that the sum of coordinates in the first column is zero, similarly in any other column. So that that superbase, I hope, is easy. But there are three more classes, and that's how I produce one. So I give explicit formally, and you might notice that the lengths of these vectors, they differentiate the classes. So these quadruples of lengths are different between classes. That's why the classes are not isometric. That's why we have four classes, eight superbases in each, and also coforms. So these coforms are different up to 24 permutations. Because 24 permutations, they keep any two conorms in the same column in a common column. So they could be a swap, vertical swap, but two numbers remain in the same column. That's why this 0,9 cannot be converted into 0,4. So no chance here. Okay, so this is a formal lemma covering the general case. If you have a cuboid of type V5, then we have an orthogonal basis V1, V2, V3, and any other obtuse superbase can be described as follows. So we could change signs of our initial vectors and get a coform of this type. Or we could produce a different, so I call them even superbases. So three classes, and these three classes are distinguished by the index k. So ij actually can be swapped. These two numbers can be swapped by 24 permutations, but not k. So k distinguishes here three classes. That's why it's 3 times 8. Okay, so that finishes discussions of obtuse superbases in for all three-dimensional lattices. Any questions so far? Okay, so the previous quizzes were a bit technical, so let me summarize. So why conorms, why conorms and coforms are hard to state in the form of invariants? Because in this very simple case, a primitive orthorhombic lattice with a unit cell of length ABC, we have four potential root forms. So now I take actually root products. So not squares, but root products, that's why these are correct numbers. So length of the initial unit cell. We have four potential root forms and they all differ. That's why we cannot claim, we cannot formally claim that root form is an invariant. And that's why I invented a different name. Root invariant in for this particular lattices should be simply the order triple ABC. ABC ordered, yes. Hopefully it's not a surprise. It should be an invariant of this particular type of lattices. So I don't give a formal proof, but in the paper, yes, there is a formal proof that the root invariant is an isometry invariant. This particular case, and in the next slides, you will see how this invariant is defined for other types, so that we can indeed claim the final theorem. But two lattices are isometric if and only if the root invariants coincide. If there are no questions on cuboids, let me move back to the more generic types. So for type V form, we know that any coform and similarly root form couldn't be put in this way. So now we take root products of negative scalar products. And instead of using this root form and saying that it is an invariant up to actually rather complicated permutations, I order with root products as follows. So I take simply four numbers and put this triple. So you might remember that there was a freedom to permute them by S3. So I put them simply in increasing order, and R03 is separate. It's the squared length of that vector of the hexagonal prism, vertical vector. So we have a root invariant consisting of four numbers, 3 plus 1. Bernoulli type V4, also four numbers, but arranged differently. And the permutations, all permutations are allowed. That's why we could simply put all four in increasing order. So we have an ordered quadruple as an invariant. Type V2. So only one root product is zero. This is a bit more complicated. So R01 is separate. So up to 24 permutations, it stays in the same column. But here we have the symmetry group D4. And it means that we could put the minimal element from the submatrix onto that place. And also guarantee that inequality. That inequality by an extra diagonal reflection. So we put, as you see, our root form in the most, well, in an ordered form. So I don't have a separate name, say canonical root form or ordered. So I prefer to keep it simple. So root form satisfying with inequalities. So the root invariant here consists of five numbers written as follows. And the most generic case, V1, so root form is complete, all root products not zeros. So we still have the freedom. We could permute columns. So that's why we put all the columns by the top row. And also guarantee that R13 is the minimum of that submatrix as before. So in that particular case, in the most generic case, the root invariant is indeed the root form. So the same six numbers. Okay, so all root invariants are now formally defined. And yes, I can finally state the theorem. Two lattices in R3 are isometric if and only if they have the same root invariant. And we compare root invariants, well, number by number. So no permutations involved, since I have ordered all numbers in this root invariant, so we simply compare them component wise. And this diagram explains, summarizes all our developments. So you might remember we started from the problem to understand lattices up to isometry, because this space, lattice isometry space, is infinite, continuous, complicated. And in the past, it was studied by trying to find, for example, a reduced basis. However, it is well known since 1980 due to Larry and Herbert that this reduced basis are discontinuous on the perturbations of lattices. That's why what did Conway and Delaunay? They considered superbases, and there is a much smaller number of superbases up to, as you have seen, 4 in 2 dimensions and up to 32 in 3 dimensions. So we still need some equivalence in the 3-dimensional case, because in the 3-dimensional case we could have up to 4 non-isometric superbases. But this is a big reduction, and with superbase lemmas from previous slides, they explain this bijection. Now, the classification theorem says that the lattice isometry space is in a one-to-one correspondence with a much simpler space of root, so root invariant space, space of root invariants, Ri. So in a generic case, this Ri is a 2x3 matrix, but for a cubic lattice, it's a triple of H lengths. Yeah, I haven't finished yet. This is simply a classification. Now we will discuss maps. Any questions? Any questions on the classification? Okay, so the talk promised visual maps. Yes, I will show some maps, but in the future they will be even more. So because Matt was very busy with teaching this semester, so we hope to produce many more soon. Okay, so let's start from the simpler case. Voronoi type V5, so cuboid, rectangular lattices, rather simple. And the fifth Voronoi map. So of course there will be other Voronoi maps for other types, but today I'll present the simplest only. So if you would like to visualize the space of all Voronoi of all lattices of Voronoi type V5, the root invariants are ordered triples ABC. And for example, one way to see it, we could have, for example, do it in 3 dimensions directly. So plotting 3 coordinates ABC. But if you'd like to have a simpler picture, then my suggestion is to consider the following projection. So A is less than B less than C, or in singular cases y equal, we have 1 minus AC. So this is a number between 0 and 1, and this is also between 0 and 1. So imagine a square, a unit square, but actually this is also a triangle. Sorry, smaller than a square. It is simply a triangle because the second coordinate is less than the first, because B is less than C. So within this type, type 5, there are 3 Bravais classes. So the most generic class is primitive orthorhombic on the next slide. But first, let me explain even the simplest, simple cubic lattices. So Bravais class CP, the root invariant consists of 3 equal numbers, and under this map, we all map to the origin. So imagine we have a triangle, and in the origin, we'll have all cubic lattices. Simple tetragonal lattices, class TP when two of these numbers are equal. So there are two subcases here, and in one subcase we'll have a diagonal in the triangle and a horizontal edge. So let me now show this triangle. So that's the triangle. So that's the diagonal, the horizontal edge, the origin is at the bottom left corner as usual. But here we show all primitive orthorhombic lattices. So this is the Bravais class OP, and the lattices are extracted from the Cambridge structural database. So Matt has found more than 100,000 crystals in the CSD whose lattices are marked as primitive orthorhombic. And this fifth Voronoi map shows all these primitive orthorhombic lattices here. So for simplicity, we exclude lattices on the diagonal and also on the horizontal edge. So no cubic lattices, no simple tetragonal, only primitive orthorhombic, to not to disturb colors, because colors here correspond to the number of lattices. So where dots with darker colors mean that at this particular spot we have many lattices in the CSD of this type. So with these parameters. And you see, yeah, we're actually close to cubic lattices. So we have more concentration closer to the diagonal, which is probably natural to expect. Let me now show the diagonal separately. So what happens on the diagonal? So this is the one-dimensional plot. And instead of drawing colorful dots on the diagonal, let's show it in a more visual way as a histogram. So this is a histogram of all simple cubic lattices corresponding to the diagonal from the previous slide. So on the horizontal axis, we simply have the side length. So you see changing from about 3 angstroms to even over 60. And the height corresponds to the number of lattices whose side length A is in corresponding small bin. So I guess there is a single outlier here. So exactly one lattice with a very high side, large side, but everything else, so you see more than 4,000 here. Any questions on these plots?
Vitaly, I just wanted to check for my own sanity. Sure. The cubic lattices in the previous plot would all live at the origin in one big dot.
Oh, sorry. Yeah, you're absolutely right. So thank you for your correction, of course. Yeah, cubic lattices indeed live at the origin. On the diagonal, we have not cubic lattices, we have simple tetragonal lattices, right? So we should plot them separately. Yeah, sorry, we don't have this histogram yet, but yeah, in the future, there will be a histogram.
Correct. I might contribute that looking initially at where they are, if you look at the density of the tetragonal lattices, mm-hmm. they are precisely where you can see a density of orthorhombic lattices in the interior, as it were. So,
yeah. So indeed, I have seen your extra plot, Matt. Yes, correct. Yeah. Sorry that I didn't include it only for time reasons.
No, sure.
Okay, thank you. Any more questions? Thank you for your correction, Matt. Okay, so in the last 10 minutes, let's move towards a metric, because about 2 months ago, so when I started to talk about these root forms and invariants, yes, I promised a metric, and today you will see finally a formula. Yes. So why is it complicated? This root invariant space splits into 5 subspaces. So you have seen that we have subdivided our lattices into 5 subclasses, Voronoi types. And for each type, you have different numbers of parameters from 3 for type V5 to 6 in the most generic type. So within a single type, it's actually trivial. Within a single type, we simply can take any metric on root invariants, no problem. So the challenge is to define a single metric on the union of all these subspaces. So before I explain how to do it, let me first convert any root invariant into a vector of length 6. So in the generic case, we simply write all these root products in this way. And for other types, for example, when you have, say, zeros on the top, we have these zeros at the beginning of this vector. So we keep so exactly the same positions. So 2, 3, 1, 3, 1, 2. So the same positions for all root products. So why cannot we compare the resulting six-dimensional vectors? So why doesn't it work? Okay, let's consider the following typical example. So it's a simple example, but I think it's typical. So actually, well, see type V4 here with two zero root products. So these two root forms, they define two lattices, lambda 1, lambda 2. And we consider them for a small epsilon. So let's look at the corresponding root vectors. So the root vectors look like as follows. So you have epsilon A in positions 3, 4, but then B and C are swapped. Okay, so that's the difference between them. And as six-dimensional vectors, they could be quite distant because with difference C minus B could be a large number. But for any ABC, if epsilon is zero, well, imagine epsilon is becoming zero. So what happens? So these lattices are based on a hexagonal prism. So the Voronoi domain is rather simple, hexagonal prism, but this hexagon in a prism, it is becoming a rectangle. But it might become a rectangle in two different ways. So it could become a rectangle on AB or a rectangle on AC. So that's why they look differently in terms of these vectors, but they both converge tend to the same primitive orthorhombic lattice with sides ABC. When epsilon is becoming zero, with two lattices which look differently and distant, they are approaching the same common neighbor of a high Voronoi type. That's the problem. Okay, so that's why we need to understand how these spaces connect with each other. So in the most general case, this six-parameter subspace RIS, root isometry subspace, it has a boundary. It has a boundary which we could understand as follows. So let's project our subspace to the next one. So let's make this first smallest actually root product zero. So we simply map it to this subspace RIS2, and informally I still represent it as a root form, although remember this root form has more symmetry, so that's why it's better to write it in as an invariant with 5 numbers. So when we do this projection, it's important to look at the inverse image. When we go back from this 5 numbers back, we realize that there is ambiguity. We could swap these two root products. These two root forms, they are equivalent in the space RIS2 because of larger symmetries, but they are not equivalent in the more restrictive space. Formally, it's the boundary of RIS1. So up to 24 permutations, they are not equivalent. So that's why this inverse image is important to describe explicitly, and we have done it for all types, so for all pairs, VI, VJ. Right, so this is a bit technical, so that's why I don't go to these technicalities, but I already written in the paper. Now, to define a metric, so we need a couple of more steps. Right, so since any lattice lambda j has several inverse images, as I demonstrated on the previous slide, in long boundary of a lower symmetry subspace RIS I, so here I is less than j, it means what we need to carefully compute the distance from lambda I to with inverse images on the boundary. Okay, let me maybe go back one slide. Yeah, and explain it again here. So if you would like to compute a distance, so imagine a distance from a generic lattice, lambda one, you would like to compute a distance from lambda one, so arbitrary, see all six root products positive. We would like to compute a distance to what lattice in the space RIS2 of higher symmetries. Then we should look not only by direct comparison, so it's not simply comparing six dimensional vectors, but also look at these inverse images. So we need to look at distances from lambda one to these two inverse images as well, because they might be close them. Okay, more formally. So fix two indices ij, and yes, we need to exclude one pair, 3, 4, because these two Voronoi types are parallel, so they are not extensions of each other. But for any other pair, if you take a lattice lambda I in a lower symmetry space, I would say a lower Voronoi type, and a high Voronoi type vj, when we first define, I call it a bounded distance. So formally it's not a metric yet, but I use the word distance, so in quotes. So it's simply a number, yeah, positive, non-negative number defined for these two lattices. So this bounded distance, so it's a distance to inverse images in the boundary. So you see lambda I is fixed. So we take this six dimensional root vector, okay? And we compare this six dimensional root vector of lambda I with root vectors, also six dimensional, of inverse images of lambda j. So we lift lambda j to potentially several inverse images. So that's why we have the minimum here, and compare all these distances. So we take the minimum. And the minimization here is very simple, because the inverse images will contain only up to six different lattices. So it's a minimum of up to six numbers. Okay, so this is a distance to the boundary. So not yet a metric. Metric appears here, but before the metric appears, I need one more extra. So I call it triple distance TD, which compares, so here we compare two lattices, lambda I, lambda j, but ij here could be the same. So we could compare lattices of any types. So previously so this inequality should be removed. Sorry, I and j here are arbitrary. And I define here, well, maximum of two indices ij, but in one specific case, when we have Voronoi types 3 and 4, we need to take higher Voronoi type v5. Yeah, because, well, it's not a linear hierarchy. So if you fix with higher Voronoi type k, as high as ij or even high up to 5. For a fixed type k, we define the triple distance as the minimum of this sum. So what is it? So we measure distance from initial lattice lambda I to a lattice of a higher Voronoi type lambda k, and then back to, and then to lambda j. So k here is a higher Voronoi type, and we need to consider this potentially close neighbors in higher Voronoi types. Okay, so this minimization is a bit more complicated than the previous one because we need to consider all potential lattices of higher Voronoi types. However, if we use a simple base distance on six-dimensional vectors, for example, the Euclidean distance, then I am pretty sure that we'll soon write down explicit formulae for this minimization, similar to the two-dimensional case. So you might remember the two-dimensional case for orient for lattices considered up to orientation preserving isometry, there was also minimization over formally infinitely many lattices. However, we have resolved this minimization explicitly, and we'll do the same here. Okay, so this is in a certain sense, this is a shortcut. So we go from lambda I to lambda j using lambda k. And yes, this shortcut is needed to guarantee the triangle axiom of a metric. Okay, so finally, after all these auxiliary distances, boundary distance, and triple distance, that's the final formula for the root metric. So we take any lattices lambda I, lambda j, and take the following minimum. So the first term is the naive approach. So take the distance between six-dimensional vectors. But we have seen this is not enough. It could be a bit too large. So because of an extra closer common neighbor. That's why we should consider all these potential close neighbors in higher Voronoi types and take the minimum of all these quantities. So this minimization is now really simple. So we have one distance here and k here varies. Well, here k could be 2. What could be k? 2, 3, 4, 5 maximum. Okay. any questions before I finish? Okay, so indeed, I hope to finish in a minute, and this is the final slide. So this final slide shows that we actually aim higher. We aim much higher than for a metric. We think we have, we can define not only a metric, we can define shortest paths, geodesics, and even linear combinations of lattices. So we could consider lattices as vectors in a linear space. For example, we could take an average of two lattices. Well, that picture is for two-dimensional lattices from my previous talk. Only one simple example. So for two-dimensional lattices, everything was easy. And you might remember that the complete invariant root form consists of three numbers that live in a triangular cone. And then with triangular cone, it's very easy to take a linear combination, so or the average. So simply connect two triples of points by straight line and take the middle. For example, let's take a triple 011 for a square lattice and another triple 111 for a hexagonal lattice. Yeah, it's easy to take average. We get another triple of positive numbers, and this triple corresponds to a lattice. And that lattice is centered rectangular somewhere here. I have already checked that it's not actually right in the middle. Well, it's a bit a bit high in this projected form. However, I see the computation is simple. For two-dimensional lattices, when we consider them up to general isometries. For orientation-preserving isometries, the picture is a bit more complicated, but this will be discussed in the future. Thank you very much for your attention. Let me stop.